What I'd like to do is to get us started. I want to do just a brief overview of our just certifications and small business programs to kind of help you understand where HUB fits into the program, and then also where the federal government programs fit in. And then we're going to introduce Arignaz Maradian from the federal government Small Business Administration, and she is the Deputy Director for the Small Business Administration here in North Carolina. So to get us started, are you able to see my screen there?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Good deal. All right. So we kind of call this the alphabet soup, and it helps us to understand some of the industry terms associated with small business programs and or certifications kind of in the space in which we work. So if you look on that left-hand side of the screen, when we're talking about state and local government, some of the terminology that you'll hear associated with state and local government, of course, our HUB certification, the Historically Underutilized Businesses certification. You may also hear it referenced as the SWUC, the Statewide Uniform Certification. And so I'm sure that many of you are here as a result of being HUB certified. You may be DBE certified. You may be working through a special program with our MBDA center. But that HUB certification is our statewide program for historically underutilized businesses. You may also hear the term small business enterprise. And so we have one through the HUB office. The Department of Transportation also runs a small business enterprise program. And so those are going to be associated with the size and or the revenue and or number of employees that a business may have. The DBE is going to refer to a couple of different things. At the state level, through the Department of Administration, that term is for a disabled business enterprise. That's going to refer to a very small number of businesses. It is, in fact, a self-certification, and it is primarily focused on businesses that serve disabled populations of people. So, for example, the Center for the Blind is one that a lot of people may be familiar with. That would be an example. Now, the other part of that or the other acronym that we use for DBE is one that is through the Department of Transportation. That's a disadvantaged business enterprise. And that also is a certification. So I kind of have it listed through state government. Technically, it is a federal government certification program, but it is administered at the state level. So that's kind of why we have it shown this way. Then you may also hear the terms MBE or WBE for minority business enterprises, women-owned business enterprises. So then just kind of jump down to the federal government certifications or programs. And what we have there, of course, I've listed again, the DBE through Department of Transportation. Then that next set of programs are administered either through the SBA or through the VA. And so you've got the 8A Business Development, the HUB Zone program, HUB Zone not to be confused with our HUB Office program. The HUB program at the state level is based on ownership, operation, and control of the business. The federal HUB Zone program is going to be based on where the business is located and also makeup of employees within that business. There's also a service disabled veteran owned small business program. Again, I won't go all into these because you'll hear more about those since we have Arignaz with us today. And there's a woman owned small business program. So those are all government related. Then on the right hand side of the screen, there are a couple of national organizations, and those, the certifications that are listed there through the Women's Business Enterprise National Council and also the National Minority Supplier Development Council, those are going to be certifications that tend to have a focus on relationships with corporations. Those certifications do involve a fee. There is a vetting process that's associated with it. And so based on how you meet the criteria, what are the goals and objectives that you have would be considerations for whether you would want to pursue those types of certifications. So everything on the left-hand side of the screen is free, at least last I knew. It's free for any of the government-related certifications. And so with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn the floor over to Arignaz Maradian from our Small Business Administration North Carolina District Office. All right, Arignaz, I'm going to unshare my screen and the floor is yours.
Okay. Do you happen to have the training to share? If not, there we go. Yes. Thank you, Derek. Thank you. Okay, so thank you for having me on today. I may have spoken with some of you either over the phone or via email or on this call because the SBA and the MBDA have, you know, had this sort of long-standing partnership to, you know, provide certification information to small businesses such as yours. So it's a pleasure to be here. And thank you so much for having SBA on the call today. So my slide deck is, I've got about 30 or so slides. So I'm going to go through them pretty quickly. But the nice thing is that you will be sent these slides and you'll have all the slides. So I'm going through them a little quickly today, but you'll have them at the end of the training. Next slide, please. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the Hub Zone, the Women-Owned Small Business Certification, and the Service Disabled Veteran-Owned, as well as the 8A certification. Next slide, please. Just to provide some context to this whole conversation, the federal government is the world's largest buyer of goods and services. Historically, the federal government last year it purchased more than $600 billion in goods and services, and it buys just about every commodity and service. It does buy some things more than others, but generally the federal government, you know, if you look hard enough, if you drill down hard enough in your market research, you'll find just about everything that the government purchases. There is a statutory requirement that federal agencies, so the federal government as a whole, so in combining all the federal agencies, are required to have at least 23% of all buying targeted to small firms. And one of the ways they do that is through set-aside opportunities through the certification programs that we are going to be discussing today. And again, the government uses the North American Industry Classification System Code, or the NAICS code, buys just about everything, but you should know what your six-digit NAICS codes are because that's how the government purchases. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is kind of a further breakdown of what I was talking about. Of that 23%, 5% of all contracting dollars are supposed to go through women-owned small businesses. And those are small businesses that have the federal women-owned small business certification. 12%, it actually went up a percentage point from last year. 12% is to go to small disadvantaged businesses, which includes the 8A program. 3% is to go to Hub Zone businesses, and 3% is to go to service disabled veteran owned small businesses. Next slide, please. So what is a small business? So small businesses can be classified either by number of employees or revenue. Whether the number of employees classification or the revenue classification applies to your business depends on the type of industry. Basically, manufacturing industries are based off of number of employees. So the average number of employees over the past 24 months. for basically every other industry, it's average annual receipts over the past 5 years. And you can learn more about NAICS codes and drill down to your NAICS code if you don't already know what your primary industry code is. You could check out census.gov, or you can go to sba.gov/size. Next slide, please. So before anybody does any work with the federal government, they must first be registered in the System for Award Management, SAM.gov. SAM is the primary source for agencies to learn about prospective vendors. It's maintained by the GSA. A firm must register in SAM to participate as a seller in the federal space. Next slide, please. Let's talk about the HubZone certification. Next slide. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the HubZone certification. So the HubZone program was established in 1997. And really the goal of this program is to facilitate economic development in traditionally distressed areas. So basically it's a location-based certification. So you have to hire a certain percentage of your employees must live in a hub zone, and your primary business location, which is where the majority of your employees report to, must also be in a hub zone. Next slide, please. So to be generally eligible, your business must be small. It must be at least 51% owned by US citizens, tribal government, ANCs, Native Hawaiian organizations, CDCs. It must have its principal office in a hub zone and have at least, 35% of its employees as hub zone residents. Next slide, please. There was a final rule published in the Federal Register, which is basically the online platform where all the changes to federal government rules, which includes these certification programs, these are part of the federal government rules and programs. There was an update in 2019 to basically stabilize the hub zone footprint, basically make the hub zone maps, what is a hub zone and what is not a hub zone, more stable because they used to change a lot. As well, there were measures taken to increase program utilization, as well as to improve customer service. So next slide, please. So expanding and stabilizing the hub zone map. So the hub zone map is now active again. It was frozen for about 3 or 4 years or more. Actually, I think it was more like 4 years while SBA was figuring out how to implement its rules related to a more consistent map process. Rural areas can now be added as hub zones. Governors can designate rural areas. In fact, here in North Carolina, our governor designated, I think, around 8 or so rural areas as hub zones, and those were approved by SBA. And if you are purchasing a building or entering into a long-term lease of 10 years or more, you may maintain hub zone eligibility in that location, even if the hub zone map changes. Next slide, please. So increasing program utilization. There is a residency requirement that is a little easier now. So for employees of hub zone owned businesses, as long as you were an employee 6 months before the certification period, whenever that is for your company, and 6 months after the certification period, that employee can essentially be grandfathered in as part of that meeting that 35% hub zone requirement. If the event is they move out of that hub zone. And now contract verification is basically only at the time of initial offer, whereas there used to be a contract verification required at time of initial offer and time of award. Now it's at initial offer only. So it's basically SBA is trying to streamline the requirements to make it a little easier to maintain HubZone certification. Next slide, please. There's also faster certification within 60 days of a completed submission. You should be receiving a decision from the HubZone office. There is a platform that has not yet been implemented yet, but there is a platform that will be integrated with the HubZone certification. So we're still using the older platform, but the newer platform will eventually be coming out, which will make it easier, like a more streamlined and easier, more intuitive application process. There's also the early engagement initiative that basically says if you work with a local SBA resource partner that is part of this early engagement initiative and you apply your application, seeing that you already worked on your application with a SBA resource partner, your application would be bumped up or expedited, essentially. Next slide. Excuse me. If you go to sba.gov/HubZone, you can learn more about the program. And that is where you can apply as well. sba.gov/HubZone. There's an application link and it will take you to the system where you can apply. Next slide, please. Women-owned small business certification program. Next slide. Okay, so the Women-Owned Small Business Certification Program, or WASB program, is a formal certification. So it is a application you submit to SBA where the applicant is reviewed, the small business is reviewed, and a decision is made on that business. Now, the Women-Owned Small Business Certification at the federal level is intended to be used for women-owned small business set-aside opportunities. So all these certifications that I'm talking about today have set-aside opportunities that are specifically for the pool of companies that have that certification. So the Women-Owned Small Business Certification is the same way. There's opportunities at the federal level that are set aside for WASB women-owned small business companies. Next slide, please. So thinking about if the WASB certification is appropriate for you, 51% of ownership must be with women or a single woman, you know, one woman or women must comprise 51% of the ownership. The highest officer position must be a woman or the women as well. So basically, the company has to be owned and controlled by women. Proper NAICS codes. There are only certain NAICS codes which are set aside under the Women-Owned Small Business Program. And so those are NAICS codes where women businesses are underrepresented. So you do have to check. And as long as your company performs one of those NAICS codes is under, you know, performs work under one of those industries, then that is a check basically for you. Managerial experience must reside with the woman or women that are controlling the company. They must also be managing the daily operations of the business as well. So it cannot be indirectly owned by these women. There's no minimum time to be in business. Next slide, please. There's also a subset certification that's part of the economic disadvantage. And that is the personal net worth, 3-year average income, and fair market value of all assets. So in order to qualify for economically disadvantaged women-owned small business set-asides, your personal net worth must be less than $750,000. That's your assets minus your liabilities. Your 3-year average income cannot exceed $350,000. Your 3-year average income, so that's average. And then the fair market value of all your assets cannot exceed $6 million. Next slide, please. So to learn, so there are a total of 364 NAICS codes that apply under the WASB certification that can be set aside under the WASB certification. There's those same 364 plus an additional 80 NAICS codes that can be applied under the Ed WASB program. You can learn more about the NAICS codes, which NAICS codes apply, if you go to sba.gov/WOSB. sba.gov/WOSB. There's the rule of two. As long as a contracting officer has a reasonable expectation based on their market research that two or more WASBs will submit an offer, they will be allowed to set aside that contract under the WASB program. Next slide, please. Okay, there were certification changes many years ago in July of 2020. Basically, the requirement shifted from a self-certification to a formal certification. So instead of being, you know, instead of allowing companies to go into SAM.gov and self-certify themselves as WASB and be eligible for WASB or ED WASB set aside contracts, they made the certification formalized. So you had to actually apply for certification. You can apply for free directly through SBA's website. WOSB.certify.sba.gov, or you can work with a third-party certifier, which you do have to pay for third-party certifiers, but they can also help you get certified. Next slide, please. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so the website is actually wosb.certify.sba.gov. I think this PowerPoint is a little bit of an outdated PowerPoint. We will definitely send you the updated PowerPoint. So with the correct website, which is wosb.certify.sba.gov, that is beta is no longer the website to apply to the Women-Owned Small Business Program, but the slides you will receive will have the correct website. Next slide, please. Service-disabled veteran-owned small business. Next slide. There's also the service-disabled veteran-owned small business certification. Which is a formal certification. And I think these slides are a little outdated. I think that, did I accidentally send the wrong slides? Because this is now a formal certification now. So the service disabled, veteran owned, small, let me go ahead and let me share. Let me go ahead and open the PowerPoint presentation and share that PowerPoint presentation. So the veteran-owned small business certification is now a formal certification. you can go to our website, sba.gov, and there's the vet cert page that you can find on sba.gov that will lead you to the application process, as well as share with you a little more about the certification. But thinking about whether or not the service disabled veteran owned certification is appropriate for you, you want to consider, does 51% of the business have ownership, direct ownership by a service disabled veteran? Is that service disabled veteran the highest officer position? You do have to have the proper NAICS codes, and this doesn't mean that there are only certain NAICS codes that are eligible under the program, but you do have to ensure and consider which NAICS codes your business works within, and whether or not the government purchases and how much they purchase. So you always want to do the market research. The service disabled veteran also must have the managerial experience and manage the daily operations of the program. Okay, so in 2023, the VA, some of you may be certified or may have been certified under the VA's Vet Cert program. The VA's CVE program. Well, that program has now moved to SBA, and it is called the Vet Cert Program. So you no longer certify through the VA as a formal certification and through SBA as a self-certification. You now must, there's only one platform, and it's through SBA as a formal certification. So if you're currently a self-certified SDVOSB, you basically have until the end of this year to submit your application to SBA if you would like to continue maintaining a service-disabled veteran-owned certification. So that's a question we get a lot from service-disabled veteran-owned businesses, and there's your answer. So you can currently maintain the self-certification until the end of 2023, as long as you apply for the formal certification prior to the end of 2023.
Okay, thank you, Ari. I think I was going to ask a question, but you just clarified it. So it's the end of the calendar year, 2023,
yes,
that needs to be done. So SDVOSB goes away, and then the Vet Cert is the new one that has come onto the scene.
Yes. So you definitely want to, I mean, if you are serious, then you definitely want to start the application process, like sooner than later. If you are serious about maintaining the certification, if you're not sure about maintaining the certification, you know, if you're not sure if you're going to maintain it, you have some time. But, you know, if you know you want to maintain it, I would just apply. Though what I can say is that I have heard that the application process is very simple and people are being approved within like a couple weeks.
Okay. All right. Thank you. While I'm here, I'm going to go ahead and take one question. I see a hand that's raised. So please unmute and go ahead and ask your question, Shauna.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
My question is about the HUB certification. I am HUB certified, woman certified under myself. But my husband has a part of the business, and I'm not sure. How do I find out if he needs to change that VA situation? Because he's 25% owner of my business, and we're supposed to be both HUB certified under women and veterans, but I do not know.
Okay, so it's so the service. So in order for the business to have a service disabled veteran owned designation, it needs to be 51% owned and controlled by the service disabled veteran. So if it's your husband that's the service disabled veteran and he's 25% owner, the certification wouldn't apply to the business. So okay. In other words, you wouldn't need to apply.
Okay. And because I'm HUB certified and minority business and woman owned, I don't have to apply for something different, do I?
So the HUB certification, again, is totally separate from the service disabled or the new vet.
Okay. So, I think that's where my confusion came.
Okay.
I was thinking all right. It was all one thing. Thank you. You cleared okay. Me up when you said that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Certainly.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. You're welcome. And thank you. Arnella, let's go ahead and take your question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. My question is, are you limited to only being approved for one certification, or can you apply for multiple certifications?
You can apply for whatever certifications you're eligible for. Absolutely. You do want to think about whether it makes sense for you to apply, because, you know, it's one thing to get certified, then you have to maintain that certification, right? So you have to think about, am I currently working within the federal government? Am I already selling my goods and services to the federal government? Am I seriously thinking about doing it? And have I done the market research to understand which agencies are my potential client? And have I started building those relationships? Because the certification is basically a license for you to hunt for certain types of set-aside contracts. It's not a guarantee that you're going to get federal contracts. But it does limit your pool because you're only going up against other similarly situated companies.
Okay, but the we haven't talked about it yet. I guess I'll just wait for the AA. From my understanding, that's a federal contract, correct?
That is the federal level.
Yes. The 8A certification is another small business certification, and it has very similar it's very similar to the woman-owned small business, the economically disadvantaged woman-owned small business certification, in that there is a requirement that the owner is economically disadvantaged. Same requirements as woman-owned small business.
Okay. And so there are a few more hands up, Argnaz, but I want to make sure we have time to cover your content. Do you want to take more questions now or hold those till the end?
Let's hold them to the end. Let me keep on going.
Okay.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit. Okay, so going back here, so these are the regulations that guide various different programs. So there's the HUB zone regulations, there's the service disabled veteran owned regulations, there's the 8A regulations, there's the woman owned small business regulations as well. So if you Google, they're all in Title 13, Code of Federal Regulations, and then they sit in those different parts. So if you Google 13 CFR Part 124, for example, you can read all about the 8A program. If you Google 13 CFR 127, you can read all about the Woman-Owned Small Business Program. It's important to know where you can find more information about these various programs. And then these are some resources for you as well that can help you with a variety of different business development needs, such as building your marketing plan, building a teaming outreach plan, as well as learning more about the certifications. So these are different resource partners, both formal and informal resource partners of SBA that are located here in North Carolina. And then this is our contact information. So we can go back to the questions now.
Okay, let's see. All right, then. I'm going to browse the chat as well here to see if we missed any there. I think we've gotten multiple certifications. I tell you what, while I do that, let me go ahead and take the next person who has a hand up. Rocio, please go ahead with your question.
Good morning. I would like to know if it's required to be a citizen to participate in the certification for WOSB certification. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Rocio. Yes, you do have to be a U.S. citizen. 100% of the ownership must be U.S. citizens for all the certifications, except for the Hub Zone certification, where 51% of the ownership must be U.S. citizens.
In other words, I understand in my case, I have 51% of the company, I am resident permanent. Can I apply for that certification?
You are a resident? Is that what you said?
Correct.
Okay. It is for U.S. citizens. The residency wouldn't apply, unfortunately. However, with a Hub Zone, 51% of the ownership must be U.S. citizens, but then 49% can be a resident.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you. And then here's a question in the chat from Gloria. Is there a percentage requirement for service disability to qualify?
No, the percentage is zero. So as long as you are 0%, then, and you have your disability letter and your DD-214 form, then that covers that.
Okay. And then there's a question, how long does it take for you to be approved for EDWOSB once you have a WOSB?
So the EDWOSB is part of the WOSB application. So you're applying for the WOSB application, and then you'll get the question if you want to also, within that application, apply for the EDWOSB. So basically, it will take longer, the EDWOSB, because they're looking at financials, but they're not two separate applications in terms of the process. It's like a subpart of the WOSB application.
All right, so I'm going to jump back to the folks that have hands raised. Burnett, please go ahead with your question.
Hi, my question is, so we're Hub certified and I am setting up my SAM account. My SAM account was not approved. Is there a resource that I can utilize to help provide guidance? And I saw you provided a list of resources. If it's one of those, which resource would be the best fit?
So you said your SAM was not approved. I would say, I don't know what kind of comments you have, Shay, on that, but I would say, you know, outside of the MBDA, which you can, I mean, if you want to say, speak to that, Shay, the GCAP, or which the Government Contracting Assistance Program, or the Women's Business Center.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, yeah, there is some assistance that is provided through MBDA for clients of MBDA. And so if you need more information about that one, I don't know if you're currently a client there or not.
Not sure if I am.
Okay.
If the information, I see that there's an office downtown Raleigh. Is that the best approach?
Yeah, so I tell you what, let's go ahead and have you, we'll have someone from the office contact you. I'll give you my information at this point and we'll start you there. Okay.
Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you. Shakiri, please go ahead with your question.
Yes, good morning. I was wanting to know, when we're applying for federal certifications, are we able to apply for more than one at a time? Like, is there a box you can check if you want to apply for several, or is it separate links for one?
Yeah, that's a good question, Shakiri. And you've hit upon something that is important. SBA is currently building a system, which they've actually been actively building it for a while. They're not only in the beginning phases of it. It's been under construction for, I don't know exactly how long, but they are actively working on completing a system that enables businesses like yours to apply to several certifications at one time. That system is not ready yet. And I don't know when it will be ready, but I'm hearing grumblings that it's on its latter stages.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you. And next we have John. Please go with your question.
My question is, can you certify multiple businesses as long as you meet the hub zone requirements?
Say that again, John. Can you repeat that? I want to make sure I understand what you're asking.
Okay. If I got multiple businesses, is there a limit as to how many businesses you can get HOPS certified for?
So let's say you are the owner of multiple businesses and they're all in different hub zones and they're different types of businesses, like that you're
right,
saying?
Correct.
So technically, yes, but there may be issues that arise related to your ability to devote 100% of your time to all those businesses, because you have to be in control of those businesses, and the ownership and control has to be, you have to directly own and control the businesses. So I could see that as being a potential issue, as well as they would all be affiliated businesses because they're all majority owned by the same person. And that could have size implications, which would hit business could potentially not be considered small because it's affiliated with all these other businesses.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And these concepts apply to all the certifications.
Right. Okay, I'm going to go ahead. Thank you, John. I'm going to go ahead and take a question from the chat. Our business opportunities, waste and recycling, are often managed at the local and state level as opposed to federally. While we are HUB certified in North Carolina, is there a formal national HUB or WASB designation that allows other local and state governments to utilize our services to bid directly on these local and state contracts. Because we are a North Carolina business, we cannot apply as a hub in each state. So again, from the state hub certification point of view, no, there is not a national hub designation across the states. Those are managed literally state by state, and not all states have a hub program. The WASB designation, again, is federal. So I'm going to have Ari take that one.
Yes. So the WASB certification is for the purpose of bidding and being awarded federal contracts. So basically contracts that are managed by the federal government, not the state government. So it's possible in some states or some cities or something along those lines, they have a agreement where they choose to accept the WASB certification as like their woman-owned small business certification, but it's not a consistent application. So it would just be like, does that city have their own certification, or are they saying we accept the SBA federal WASB certification? So, yeah, so the WASB certification that we are talking about today is for federal set-aside opportunities that are managed with federal taxpayer dollars.
Okay, and so thank you again for that question. The next question from Eddie, does the 8A certification serve as a procurement vehicle akin to GSA, or is it simply a certification with goals?
It's not a procurement vehicle. The 8A certification has... So it has the same economic disadvantage requirements as the WASB certification does. It's a 9-year program. The main benefit of the 8A certification is that there's a special sole source authority that is unlike other sole source authorities in the federal government, where normally with sole source authorities, you have to be the only company that can perform that work. Like, it's a very highly specialized job. Therefore, the federal government justifies not competing that contract and just awarding your company that contract. Under the 8A program, that's a 9-year term, you can be sole sourced a contract with a value up to $4.5 million that's not competed simply because you have the 8A certification and the contracting officer believes you can perform the work at a fair and reasonable price. So it's not a contract vehicle, like, but I understand why you're asking that question, but it's a certification that's 9 years that you have to qualify for, similar to the WASB eligibility requirements, and you get that sole source benefit. And it's essentially supposed to help develop your business during the course of those 9 years. So it's supposed to make it a little easier for you to get contracts because they're direct award contracts that are awarded based off of your capabilities and based off of your networking, contracting officers understanding your capabilities and capacity.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much. And so next question from Daniela, does a company registered in South Carolina or other state can get the HUB certification? If so, is the process the same as if they were registered in North Carolina? So yeah, you do not have to be in the state of North Carolina to be eligible to apply for HUB certification. And so, yes. In fact, one thing I will mention is that we are in transition. The HUB certification process is in fact going online starting next week. So you'll be able to go directly to the electronic vendor portal to be able to submit your application. Okay. And then Tawanda says, did you check fsd.gov to see why you weren't approved? Okay, so I guess that's back to the SAM.gov registration. And so, yes,
we're going to make sure.
Make sure that all those resources have already been utilized. All right, Joseph is making a similar contact comment. All right, Key Realty Services. Where would I find the application to apply for the WASB? Also, who would I contact to schedule an appointment to get assistance with understanding the process?
If you go to sba.gov/WOSB, it's a very, very helpful page that's all about the WASB program, and it has the link on applying to the program. So you can apply through sba.gov/WASB, which links you to wosb.certify.sba.gov. You can also learn about the program at that page as well. That page has very good, like, fundamental information about the program, including, like I was mentioning earlier, those links, like the link to the NAICS codes, which NAICS codes are applicable to the WASB program and which ones are not. So.
Right.
I mean, I did see that after I sent the chat for that, there is a lot of information on here. And when you click on it, it does link you to, because on the website, it still has the beta, but it does link you to the WOSB, but then it connects you to SAM. And I do recall before trying to get myself registered for SAM, but there I kept having an error. So, I mean, it would be very helpful to me. This page has a lot of information, but I would love to speak to an individual for 30 minutes to just try to get an understanding of quite a few things so that I can get myself moving. How would I do that? Who would I contact?
So it sounds to me like there might, like you're trying to get, because in order to apply to the WASB certification, you have to have an active SAM.gov account already, right?
Right, so, exactly.
Yes, so I would suggest you either reach out to the Women's Business Center or the Small Business Center.
Okay, thank you.
And you'll get the slides with the link.
All right. Thank you all again. We're going to move on. Tanisha Langley, please unmute and ask your question.
Thank you so much, Ms. Meridian and Ms. McIntyre. And please forgive me if I didn't say your name correctly. I have a very quick question as it pertains to the WASB and the EdWASB. I do understand that the EdWASB is within your actual application, and they're kind of two separate things. EdWASB takes a little bit longer, but my question is, do they have it set up that once you apply and you get accepted, that you can go ahead and start putting your WASB delegation certifications on your things while you wait for the EdWASB? Or if you check you want the EdWASB 2, then you won't get it until both of those have been processed?
I don't think that's the case. I think you can get the WASB first and then the EdWASB is processing.
Okay, thank you, because I didn't want to try to click that and then it holds me up from getting that certification. So thank you so very much, but I would definitely follow up with the Women's Business Center. Thank you.
Uh-huh. All right. Thank you again. Cheryl, we'll take your question.
Good morning. The question that I have is whether firms that apply for the WASB or the 8A certifications, whether or not they are required to already have revenues coming in before they are eligible for either of those programs.
Yes, there will. So there's no minimum revenue requirement. It's not like if it's this industry, you need this amount of revenue. But for the 8A program, there is a review of the potential for success of the company. And because it's a 9-year program only, which I know 9 years sounds like a long time, but it's not. It's not a long time in the context of these certifications. You do want to have some revenue and you do want to have past performance. There is a waiver you can submit for the 8A certification, but it will benefit your company greatly if you already have past performance and revenue. Sure. But with the women-owned small business, because that's not like a timed, it's not only 9 years. Mm-hmm. There isn't a revenue requirement, but also if you get certified now, it's not like your clock starts kind of a thing, but okay. Your clock starts with the 8A program.
Okay. All right. Perfect. Thank you so much. That's helpful.
Okay. All right. And we'll wrap up with Donnie Walker. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing your name. All right, we'll go on to Tanisha. Did you have another question?
I have a question that I want to circle back regarding the multiple businesses. The question that was asked earlier about multiple businesses in an 8A certification situation. You mentioned that the question would probably come in the certifier's mind regarding your ability to control various business or multiple businesses and be 51% in control of them. How does size in terms of revenue play into that thought? And how will that affect multiple businesses being owned by the same person? How will that affect the certification? Because I have a company that's located in South Carolina, and I am 51% owner, and it's something that can be remotely managed. And in this day and age of remote business platform, that is very possible where it wasn't before. So I just want you to expand a little bit more on that.
Yes, that's a good question. Thank you. So the size matters in terms of if you have affiliated companies, the overall arching revenue those companies combined is applied to that one business. So let's say it's a business with a $15 million size standard because it's an engineering company. If all of your businesses combined have revenue averaged over 5 years more than that, you know, exceed the size standard for an engineering NAICS code, then that company is not considered small. So I hope that kind of answers part of your question, at least.
It does. Talk a little bit more, and I'm sorry to keep going, but go a little bit in further about affiliated. How does the companies have to be related, or when you
they
say
have to have common ownership and or control?
Gotcha.
Affiliation is actually, it's interesting you point that out because it is a whole other 13 CFR part 121 talks about affiliation. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different ways to be affiliated with other companies, but primarily it once again comes down to common control, common ownership, essentially.
Okay. Thank you.
Uh-huh.